Yes, so topic for today class is Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj. So Sri Devi Mataji, we have now eight devotees online. Over to you, Mataji.
Okay, all right. Thank you. So my humble obeisances to all the assembled Vaishnavas, Vancha, Kalpataruvyascha, Kripa, Sindhubhyayavacha, Patitanam, Pavanebhyo, Vaishnavebhyo, Namo Namaha. So today I've been asked to speak on the life of this great personality, Srila Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj, whose disappearance day was just a couple of days ago on Ekadashi. And even though a couple of days have gone, it's very wonderful to remember these great personalities because their lives are exemplary and they personify pure devotion to the Lord. So, and also simply hearing about these great personalities on their appearance and disappearance days and other days also is so auspicious because we get 100th of the good qualities of that Vaishnava by hearing of their glories. So, who is Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj? He's actually Guda Manjari in the spiritual world. And here he's in our disciplic succession. He is the spiritual master of our Param Guru, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Thakur Srila Prabhupada, who is the spiritual master of our Srila Prabhupada, founder Acharya of ISKCON. So that is how our disciplic succession goes. And you will be very, very intrigued to know that Srila Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj was illiterate. He couldn't even sign his name, Srila Prabhupada said. And he's a spiritual master of one of the greatest learned scholars of the century, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. How is that? So for this, we must understand that Krishna Tattva doesn't depend on mundane scholarship or academic achievements or intellectual prowess or any such thing. It depends on devotion. And Srila Prabhupada said that he was so perfect that you ask any question on Krishna Tattva, he will immediately give an answer. And the saying is also there that, you know, whoever is perfect in the science of Krishna, he is guru. Lord Chaitanya also says this, that he is perfect, and in a position to teach others is one who understands the science of Krishna consciousness. So that is how our Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj took initiation from Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj. So we'll talk about all that. First, let me begin with the invocation prayers, as we are now at 12 participants. We can begin. Om Agyanati Mirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shiva Sadi Gaura Bhaktavrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So why are these days so important? The Srila Prabhupada explains that just as the appearance and disappearance of Krishna is not an ordinary thing, it's a transcendental phenomenon. Similarly, the arrival and departure of these great personalities is very, very auspicious and also transcendental. Because they're bona fide representatives of the Lord and they're Nitya Siddhas. That means they're eternally liberated and they only come into this world to carry out the mission of the Lord. So it is very auspicious to hear about their appearance. And of the two, the disappearance is even more important than the appearance. So you might ask, how is that? The reason is when a great personality appears, it is still not known what great achievements he or she is going to do, but by the time of his disappearance, it is very obvious that this great personality is a great personality because of their unmatched feats in bhakti and their wonderful exemplary character and their great devotion to the Lord and their services to all of humanity through their acts of devotion. So that is why the disappearance day is considered more important. And what is appearance and disappearance for these great personalities? They just go somewhere else to serve the Lord in some other universe. Just as the sun rises in one place while it sets in another place, it doesn't mean it disappears. So we understand that this great personality has now gone somewhere else, because as we know, the soul is eternal. And so we say, he reasons ill who say Vaishnavas die when thou art living still in sound. The Vaishnavas die to live, and living spread the holy name around. They simply live to carry out the mission of the Lord, which is what? Spreading Krishna consciousness. And now in this particular age, it is through chanting of the holy names of Krishna. So who was Gaur Kishor Das Babaji Maharaj? He was born in a place which is now present day Bangladesh on 17 November 1838 in a grain merchant family. It was a mercantile family that he took birth in, and for many years he was a Grihastha. And the village he was born in is called Vagyana. It is near to Tipakhola. I'm looking at my notes here just to get it right. District Faridpur in present day Bangladesh. Then when his wife died, when he was just 29 years old, he gave up Grihastha life. And he came to Vrindavan. He took initiation from Sri Bhagwat Das Babaji Maharaj, who was a disciple of Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj, and began a life of being a mendicant. He wandered in the various holy places of Vrindavan, simply calling out to the holy divine couple in great lamentation, in great separation. He used to call out and lived a life of extreme renunciation. In fact, his renunciation is unmatched and unparalleled, because he was completely on the transcendental platform. He was Babaji. If you want to know how renounced he was, he would take the discarded cloth that covered corpses, wash it, and use it again. He would eat out of a rejected clay pot. And sometimes all he would eat is the mud on the banks of the Ganges or the Yamuna, and chant the holy names while he was eating it. Or he would do madhukari. What is madhukari? You beg a little food from 1 to 7 houses, and whatever people give, you just eat that. Just like a honeybee collects a little honey from every flower. That is how it is called madhukari. So this is how he was so renounced, but he was totally absorbed in love for Radha and Krishna. And every day for 30 years that he lived in Vrindavan, he would make a fresh flower garland for Kanu and Rai, as he lovingly called his divine couple. That means Krishna and Radha. And he would sing a particular bhajan where he would call out to Radha, oh Radhe, where are you? Where are you? Give me your mercy. He would reside under trees, sometimes under an overturned boat, sometimes in the hollow of a tree trunk. He was completely oblivious to all the things of this world, and he would be absorbed in his bhajan. And this way he would wander through the 12 forests of Vrindavan, and sometimes he would go to Radhakun, sometimes Shyamkun, to Giri Govardhan, to Nandagram, to Varshana, to Gokul, just calling out, hey Radhe, where are you? Let me give this servant your mercy. Like this he would call out. And this continued for 30 years. And then the divine couple came in the dream and said, go to Navadvip. My Leela is happening over there. So now you go over there to Navadvip Dham. So Gaur Kishor Das Babaji Maharaj came to Navadvip. And this was just when the Yoga Peet had been discovered as the real birthplace of Lord Chaitanya by Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, who was then a district magistrate, had done a lot of research, and he wanted to find the real birthplace of Lord Chaitanya. And finally, after a lot of research, after a lot of digging through different archives and maps and charting, you know, now the river has changed course, now it is over here, and so on and so forth, they finally discovered the real birthplace of Lord Chaitanya. And you know how this was confirmed? When he invited Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj to come, it a very wonderful and a very inexplicable phenomenon happened. Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj was then 120 years old. He was so old that he had to be carried in a basket by men to move from place to place. He just couldn't do anything. And he was so old that his eyelids were completely drooping and covering his eyes. And he had to lift his eyelids up just to see. So he was that weak and fragile as an old, old, old man. But when he was brought to the Yogapeet, he jumped out of the basket and he started dancing and jumping and leaping in the air in ecstasy that Lord Chaitanya's birth, this is really Lord Chaitanya's birthplace. So it became very clear that this is the birthplace of the Lord. And when Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj came, Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj noticed and he was very impressed with him. As soon as they saw each other, because the eternal relationship between the master and the disciple is always there, what did Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj do? He gave whatever little possessions he had. He had a tiger skin cap. He had a stamp or tilak stamp with Hare Krishna on it. He had a few knotted pieces of rope on which he would chant, you know, like how we chant on our Tulsi Mala. He gave all those things to young Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj. That time he was Bimal Prasad. He had not got him initiation even then. But he would come and he would listen to the daily discourses on the Srimad Bhagavatam by Bhakti Vinod Thakur in Swananda Sukhada Kunj in Godruman Dweep, where Bhakti Vinod Thakur was residing and giving these lectures. So Gaurakishore Das Babaji would come regularly and he would sit and listen. And Bhakti Vinod Thakur, understanding the stature and the super excellence of this great personality, told his son, Bimal Prasad, you go take initiation from him. Now a very interesting thing happens. This is actually something for us to learn from about how serious and sincere we must be to take shelter of a bona fide guru and how Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj was tested. So the first time he went to Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj, Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj used to always be approached by so many people and he had no interest in kowtowing to, you know, the materialistic, say, get out, go away to everyone. Similarly, when Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj approached, he said, go away, get out, I don't want to see anybody. So Bimal Prasad went back to his father and his father said, no, no, you go again and you ask for initiation. So Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj, who was named Bimal Prasad, went again. This time, Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj, why have you come here? Your father is a great scholar. Go and take initiation from him. So then Bimal Prasad said very humbly, but my father has asked me to approach you. So then Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj said, all right, I will ask Mahaprabhu. So Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj went away again. Again, after a few days, he came and he asked Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj very humbly, so did you ask Lord Chaitanya? Did you ask your Mahaprabhu? And then Gaurakishore Das Babaji said, I forgot to ask. See how many times Bimal Prasad had to persevere. So again, Bimal Prasad went away and again came back after a few days. And he said, what did Mahaprabhu say? What did your Lord say? And he said, I asked, but Mahaprabhu did not give any answer. By now, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj was heartbroken. His heart was breaking. And he knew that if he doesn't receive initiation, what is his life worth? And so he started speaking in a very heartbroken way. He said, there is no point in my living anymore, for what is the use of this life without being connected to the eternal divine loving couple through the mercy of the bona fide guru? I might as well give up my life. So when Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj saw how serious and how sincere he was and how much he was getting affected by his refusal, then he accepted him as a disciple. And this is the only disciple of Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj. He would absolutely refuse to entertain anyone whom he even slightly thought was a pretender. He could not tolerate pretense. He could not tolerate hypocrisy. He could not tolerate cheaters. He would drive them away saying, go away, go away. Many people, knowing that he was a Mahabhagavat, would come and try to touch his feet and he would bind up his feet in cloth and lock himself in his bhajan kutir and would refuse to come out just to avoid mundane materialistic people. In fact, his pranam mantra is Sakshad Vairagya Murtaye. Namo Gaura Kishoraya Sakshad Vairagya Murtaye. That means you are Vairagya, renunciation personified. And so people, materialistic people, he wanted to avoid at all costs. And one time he went and resided in the latrine, that means the toilet of a dharmashala, saying the smell of stool is better than associating with materialistic people. He wanted to show that he is not interested in any mundane exchanges with anyone. He was very, very elevated and therefore didn't want to waste time or waste his energy on people, you know, who were just coming to take materialistic blessings by asking for blessings from him. He didn't want to waste his time with them. Once, a woman, an old woman actually came to his bhajan kutir offering to some service to sweep the courtyard or something simple like that. And Babaji Maharaj, he went inside his bhajan kutir, he locked the place, he refused to come out. He said, unless that woman leaves this place, I'm not coming out. He was so strict in following the principles of that particular ashram, of that particular, the renounced order of life, Babaji, you know, status that he had. But this is not to say that he had hatred of women or he disrespected women, because I will share with you this particular anecdote, which will show us that his vision was perfect and his renunciation was perfect, and he was simply following the principles of that particular ashram. Now I will share with you this anecdote to illustrate the point I'm saying. When he spoke to a newly married man, this is what he spoke to honor his wife, who's a Vaishnava. Babaji Maharaj, I'm going to read out this because it's so important to hear. Babaji Maharaj spoke very gravely to a newly married man. He said, a Vaishnava wife is extremely rare and difficult to find in this world. If one has the good fortune of having one, he should see it as a benediction from Krishna. The wife worships the husband as her lord and master. Similarly, the husband should worship the wife because she is Krishna Dasi, a servant of Krishna. In this way, the husband can protect his devotional enthusiasm by not considering his wife to be his maidservant, but she is always the maidservant of Krishna. So you see how his vision was perfect, and he gave the perfect advice to everyone. He also said, one who eats very palatably bhojan will spoil his bhajan. And he would refuse to go anywhere and take any prasadam at all, just like that. Once a devotee ate some festival prasadam in his bhajan kutir, and Babaji Maharaj would not speak to him for 3 days. Why? Because he went and ate some festival prasadam at a place which was, you know, questionable. And on the fourth day, he chastised him. He said, you accepted festival prasadam given by low-class harlots and beautiful women. Because you took food without considering its origin, your bhajan is useless. So you see how strict he was, and he was setting the example for all of us that we shouldn't just take, oh, this is prasadam. This is, you know, there are sometimes in India big, big pandal programs and big, big pujas and all this is done. And, you know, they distribute big, big quantities of prasadam and people take it also. But we as devotees of, you know, ISKCON, we should ask ourselves, who is the person who cooked it? Where was it offered? Was it offered to Radha Krishna? And were the person cooking, are they chanting 16 rounds? Are they initiated? Are they qualified to do the cooking? Are they qualified to do the offering? And then only we should take Krishna prasadam and not just any prasadam. Devotee must be so careful what he is seeing, what he is hearing, what he is eating, what he is tasting, what he is putting into, he or she is putting into his system is going to affect his consciousness. So we need to be so careful about and guard our Krishna consciousness by being very careful with our interactions, with our, what we are, as I said, you know, what we are taking in through the objects of the, through the knowledge acquiring senses and through the working senses, what we are doing with that. It's very important for us to protect ourselves against the attacks of Maya. And these great souls show by the example how to be careful about our sadhana. Now, though he was a Paramahansa and on a very exalted platform, the respect he gave everyone was unmatched. He saw all the Brajavasis, every one of them, as direct personal associates of Radha and Krishna. And therefore, he would offer respects not just to every person, but to every tree, every animal, every bird, every insect, every creeper. He would offer all respects and considered them as personal associates of Lord Krishna and Radha and Vrindavan, now come to Bhauma Vrindavan. So this is how exalted he was, because his vision was that these are all personal associates of the Lord and I should offer all respects. So this is the way he would respect and honor and worship the holy Dham, by respecting and worshiping all the residents of the Dham. So, yes. So these are some of the pastimes of Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj. And I would like to interweave that with some of the pastimes of Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj, because when Bhakti Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj finally gave up his body, there were so many people, so-called Babajis, who came forward because they wanted to give him samadhi, because they knew that people will then come and give donations and put money. And so they saw this is a great way for them to make money for their own sense gratification. At that time, Sri Varsha Bhanavi Daita Devi Das, Daita Das, which is our Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj, he immediately rushed to the place, and there was a big crowd, and the Inspector General of Police was there because they were apprehending trouble and violence, because people were fighting over, no, I will take the body. It was just such a sickening thing for Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj, and he thundered in a voice so loud that he said, none of you dare touch my spiritual master's body. All of you have had illicit connections with a woman, and anyone who has not had illicit connection with a woman can dare to touch the body of Maharaj. So one by one, all those so-called Babajis left, because they were protesting how Vimal Prasad, who is not even a sannyasi, can take charge of the body, to which our Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj replied, yes, I may not be a sannyasi, but I'm a strict Naishtik Brahmachari. And if any one of you can claim that you have not had illicit connections within past 1 year, past 6 months, past 3 months, past 10 days, past 3 days, if any one of you can claim that, then you can touch the body. And if you lie, you will be ruined. And one by one, all those Babajis left because they were not up to the standard. And the Inspector General was amazed. He said, how will you take their word? And he said, how can you believe what they say? He said, I will take their word. If they say that they are pure, I will take their word. But none of them could pass that test. And so Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj took charge of Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj's transcendental body and had a samadhi made. And even now, if you visit in Yoga Pit and you go to Chaitanya Math, you can see the samadhi of Gaurakishore Das Babaji. You can circumambulate. It's right next to Radha Kund and take the blessings of this great personality. So this is how Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj, you know, honored his spiritual master, because he knew his spiritual master was a pure devotee of the Lord, Nitya Siddha devotee of the Lord, come down to the material world to give his blessings to everyone. And then, and then some years later, he took initiation from a picture of Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj, and gave himself the name Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Srila Prabhupada. When people objected, what is this? You're taking initiation from a picture. He explained and stoutly defended, saying that my spiritual master is here and I'm taking initiation, sannyas initiation from his picture. And because he was pure himself, being also a resident of the spiritual world, come down to, as a ray of Vishnu, a book describes, as an answer in prayer to Bhaktivinoda Thakur, pleading with the Lord to send someone from his personal entourage to help him in his mission of re-establishing Krishna consciousness. So that's how our Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj came to this material world. And thereafter, he undertook great, great austerities to spread Krishna consciousness. Taking the example of his own spiritual master, Srila Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj would chant 200,000 names of the Lord every day. That was 128 rounds. And so at one point, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj decided to undertake chanting of the holy names, and he would chant 300,000 names every day as a very severe form of penance, because he knew he had to prepare himself to start this worldwide movement of Krishna consciousness. And he would sit and chant all the time. When it would rain, he would just hold up an umbrella and keep chanting. And his eating was in the form of just some parched rice, and he would eat off the floor like a cow, it is described, without using his hands, because he wanted to minimize his eating. So purposefully, he would eat that way so that he ate very little. And this is the way he completed his vow, 1 billion names in 9 years, because he wanted to fortify himself, strengthen himself, purify himself even more to spread Krishna consciousness. And Srila Prabhupada said this, "Oh, my spiritual master, what austerities he undertook to spread this Krishna consciousness." And so we can see that though Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj was illiterate, he fully empowered Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj. And this is the point I want to make, because there is this beautiful verse which goes like this. Yasya deve para bhaktir yatha deve tatha guru tasya te kathita artha prakashante mahatmanaha. For one who has unflinching faith in the spiritual master and in the Supreme Lord, all the imports of the Vedic scriptures are revealed. So we can see over here a very clear example of a person having full faith in the pure spiritual master and not saying, oh, he's illiterate, cannot read, he cannot write. That is a very mundane point of view. And that is a very materialistic point of view. What is important is understanding how Krishna conscious is this person. Is he situated in transcendence? Has he overcome lust, anger, greed, illusion, pride, envy? Is he completely firmly fixed in the tattva? Those are the criterion we need to see, and not how ugly he is, how fair he is, how tall he is, how thin he is, how fat. These are all not considerations. In fact, we have to look at the spiritual master as a transcendental personality and not consider the body, the qualification, mundane material qualifications of someone in terms of seeing Krishna consciousness. I'm trying to remember if there are other pastimes that I want to share about Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj. Let me think. Yes, I think I want to share about a little bit more about initiation when Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj, and I'm going to read out from this book by Rup Vilas Prabhu. And it is written, Ray of Vishnu. So when Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj was approaching Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj to take initiation, he spoke these words with great humility, and they're very instructive. So I wanted to read it out to you, that even such a great personality as Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj is taking such a humble position, and he's speaking these words to glorify his spiritual master. I have been busy within this material world, trying to bring sense gratification within the grasp of my hand. I have often thought that by obtaining the objects of sense gratification, all my shortcomings will be fulfilled. I often attained different facets that were indeed very rare, but my own personal shortcomings were never mitigated. In this material world, I have had the association of very high class aristocratic persons. However, seeing their various deficiencies, I could not offer them praise. The most merciful Supreme Lord Gaurasundar, seeing me in such a lamentable condition at such a time of adversity, gave permission to his two dearmost devotees, Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur and Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj to grant their blessings to me, because I was always intoxicated with a worldly false ego, wanting again and again self-appraisal. I deprived myself of my own real benefit. But because of the influence of my previous birth's activities in devotional service, I came into the association of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, who was the form of my spiritual well-wisher. My spiritual master, Srila Gaur Kishore Das Babaji, would go and visit Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur and many times would reside with him. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, out of compassion for other living entities, pointed out my spiritual master, Srila Gaur Kishore Das Babaji. Upon seeing my spiritual master, the extent of my worldly false ego diminished. I knew that all the other living entities who have taken the human form of life were also fallen and low like myself. But by gradually observing the spiritual character of my master, I realized that only a Vaishnava could reside in this material world and be of exemplary character. So see how humbly, you know, Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj is submitting to his spiritual master. And let's not forget that Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Maharaj himself is a denizen of the spiritual world. He's also a Manjari. I think he's Rupa Manjari, if I'm not mistaken. And his life is also exemplary. In fact, there's a particular incident to show his real nature, his real character, which is that of an acharya. And Srila Prabhupada explained this by sharing, by relating this particular pastime when Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Maharaj was just a little baby boy, maybe about 3 or 4 years old, a particular incident happened. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur had gone to the market and he had purchased some mangoes and come back and placed them waiting to be offered. Our Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj went up and took a mango and started eating it. He was only two or three or maybe four maximum years old. Bhaktivinoda Thakur turned and told his little son in a very grave voice, "What is this? This mango has not yet been offered to the Lord and you are eating it? This is not right." And Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj was so mortified. He was so repentant. He said, "I will never eat a mango again." He was only 3 or 4 years old. He said, "Alas, I'm an offender. I have taken something that was not even offered to the Lord. I'm an offender. I will never eat mango again." And he never touched a mango the rest of his life. Throughout his life, even when he was offered a mango, he would say, "Oh no, I'm an offender. I cannot eat." And if you go to India, and if you go in the summer season, you go to the market, the whole market, wherever there are mangoes in season, you know, the fragrance of those mangoes is so intoxicating. It's like you can't resist. You want to swoon in ecstasy just thinking of eating the mango because it's so fragrant, you know, Alfonso mango and so many varieties of mangoes. In fact, it's called the king of fruits. But Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj would not touch a mango, saying, "I'm an offender." So Srila Prabhupada explained, these are the great acharyas. They show by their example of how to be firmly fixed in whatever vow we have taken. And so Maharaj Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj maintained that vow and showed by his own example of how to keep our vows. So I think I've shared, let me look at my notes and see if I'm missing something here. Maybe I can share. We do have a little time, right?
Yes, Mataji.
Here's another pastime relating to the disappearance pastime, which is what we're talking about, the anniversary of Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj's pastime. So when finally the body was handed over, the transcendental body, again, some people started raising objections. They said, according to Srila Prabhupada's instructions, we had the good fortune to carry the spiritual body of Paramahansa Babaji Maharaj, which was lying on the ground. And then some people started giving advice again to Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj, and this is what he says. They said, when Babaji Maharaj was manifest, he said that his body should be dragged through the streets of Sridham Navadvip so that it may be bathed in the dust of this holy land. Therefore, it is befitting to observe the command of Babaji Maharaj. And Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj said, although we are fools, inexperienced and offenders, we will still not be disinclined to understand the true meaning of those humility-filled words which were spoken by my Gurudev in order to destroy the pride of worldly-minded people. For even Krishna Chandra personally thinks himself to be successful if he carries my Sri Gurudev on his head or his shoulders. After the departure of Thakur Haridas, Sri Gaurasundar took the spiritually blissful body of Haridas Thakur on his lap and danced. What dignity he adorned it with. Therefore, following in the footsteps of Sriman Mahaprabhu, we shall also bear Babaji Maharaj's spiritually blissful body on our heads. So Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj would just not allow, you know, the people to do all this nonsense. Oh, imagine a transcendental spiritual personality from the spiritual world, and they're thinking that they should drag that body through the streets. See the foolishness of people who have no idea and who simply go by, what to say, lip service to the guru. They come up with all these, you know, crazy, foolish ideas. But Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj, being firmly fixed in the truth of who his guru is and knowing the Siddhanta correctly, knowing the etiquette correctly, refused to allow all this nonsense to go on and made sure that the samadhi as well as the body of his spiritual master was duly respected, honored, worshipped and revered and put properly into samadhi. So that's what I wanted to share. And the date of his departure was November 17, 1915. It was just a year after Bhaktivinoda Thakur had also left the world. So I think I've shared all the points that I had prepared. Of course, there may be many more, and I will now open it up so that everybody can join in and share if they have some pastimes or anecdotes to relate about Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj, or if they have any questions, comments, corrections, we can open it up. Thank you very much for listening so patiently. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji, for giving us such nice nectar on beautiful, austere, I would say, life of Srila Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj. And a lot to learn from his life, who did not waste a single moment, as you rightly mentioned, in mundane activities. So thank you very much. Hare Krishna, dear devotees. If you have any questions, comments, or realization, please unmute yourself now, or you can type in chat window. Thank you.
Hare Krishna Mataji, please accept my humble obeisances, all glories to Srila Prabhupada and Guru Maharaj.
Thank you so much. My humble obeisances, all glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to our wonderful Gurudev.
Thank you so much, Mataji, for this wonderful class. I remember some of the pastimes while you were talking. I watched all the series of Abhay Charan movie in YouTube. So I saw some pastimes there too. So very nice to know about more about Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj and Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Mataji. Yeah, Maharaj. Yeah, very nice. Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you. Thank you for listening so patiently. It's hard to listen, you know, to one person, you know, rambling on and on and on. You know, it's very difficult to pay attention because you're like, oh, okay, when will this end? Unless the speaker is really able to hold the attention of the audience, it's very, very, and we don't have so much spiritual potency, you know, it's really, we are just trying to humbly do some service. So thank you for listening patiently.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Sukhavaha. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Prabhupada, all glories to Gurudev. How are you?
My humble obeisances to you, Mataji, and all glories to Guru Maharaj, and all glories to Srila Prabhupada. I'm good. How are you?
Good.
It was really nice class, Mataji. Don't say that you were humbling. We were like completely engrossed in the pastime. So Gaur Kishordas Babaji Maharaj. And as Srimati Mataji said that she had heard about these pastimes. I had heard, but it was really nice to hear from you. It just reminded back each and every pastimes, and it was really, really nice. So thank you so much for that. I just wanted to say thank you. It's really
thank
nice.
You. Thank you for encouraging me in my seva.
You're doing the wonderful service, Mataji. Just inspire us and bless us.
Oh, you have to inspire me and bless me to get past my anarthas, you know. I'm seriously coming face to face with so many anarthas. I'm thinking, oh my God, I can't believe I have all this stuff inside me. You know, it's like you peel back one layer and then another layer presents itself. It's like never ending.
I think we all have to fight against the anarthas together.
Right. We are in this together. That is so true. Yes.
You know, as Guru Maharaj says, that we should make the devotee colony and then stay there and then help each other. It'll be so nice if that happens.
Yes. I long for the day when we all can come together as a God family. Even, you know, once a month, if we all just come together and talk and discuss about where we are and, you know, what our challenges and what we want our God family to pray for us. You know, just saying, I really want my God family to pray that I get over this addiction of mine or this, you know, this problem of mine or whatever it is, you know. It's very powerful when we share with our God family and our God family prays for us. So I would like that. I don't know if everyone has time, and it's an endeavor even to do that, you know.
I know it'll be nice if we can do that, like a sangha, and it'll be a nice interaction between us lot.
And I think it is very necessary, you know, it's very necessary to find strength by coming together like that, because sadhu sangha is so important for our spiritual life. And repeating Guru Maharaj, hearing about instructions, you know, what Guru Maharaj spoke to me, sharing that with others, that is so powerful. So someday we will all, you know, make that endeavor.
Hopefully.
This is great. This is wonderful that we are all listening to Guru Maharaj every day. But we need to go a step further also, I think.
Agreed with you, Mataji, definitely. Brings us together.
Mm-hmm. I want to add something, Mataji, here, if you give permission. So, yes. Yesterday, in Guru Maharaj's interview, when he was talking with Naam Rasa Prabhu, so he was telling, Guru Maharaj was telling about coming together as small groups and having reading calls and discussions. That point Guru Maharaj stressed a lot. So previously we started Chaitanya Charitamrita and we had Bhagavatam also, but now we don't have anything like that.
We can revive our book reading calls, and that could be start reading Srila Prabhupada's books once again like that as a group and discuss, and that itself could be a springboard for more. Again, coordinating and making sure everybody is able to come, all those things have to be seen, but we can make a start again.
Yes, Mataji. I remember Guru Maharaj was stressing about that point of coming into groups and doing something like this.
from reading.
And also a lot of programs are there where we can get inspired and start doing as a God family. We have a lot of programs around, and we can try to do something in our time zones also, getting together as a group. Based on time zones also, we can decide like that, like UK devotees and USA devotees like that, because sometimes the times may not be suitable. Yeah, suppose the USA evening time will be midnight for UK, so like that, so.
Right, and yeah, that is very true. Like now 6 o'clock, it's like 10:30 in India, you know, almost 6 o'clock for me is 10:30 in India, 4.5 hours ahead. And it's so difficult for them to even tune in for the daily calls because of the timings.
Yeah.
And still we have Namrata coming from all the way from India to attend the calls. Yeah. Amazing.
Mataji is very dedicated.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Thank you. Please, I am just a small servant. In fact, I want to be. I'm still not. I want to be.
Thank you.
Inspiring.
If the time changes, it would be good. Because, sometimes it becomes a little late. But it's fine. If not, I'll try to attend this time also.
Okay. Thank you, Amrita. Thank you all very much. Raj Prabhu, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
My humble obeisances. All glories to Prabhupada. All glories to Gurudev.
Vandamana Swami Maharaj. All glories to self and all glories to all the devotees assembled. I have a question because I was struggling with something, and with all the other acharyas, or most of them, we have their example, we have their teachings, like Bhaktivinoda Thakur wrote so many books, but with Srila Gaura Kishore Das Babaji, we have his example, but his example is so high, and I can't follow his example, and I can't mimic it. So, what can we learn? What are the lessons to learn from his example?
The lessons from such a great personality is his love for Radha and Krishna, his love for the divine couple, his mood of separation from Radha and Krishna, his equal vision, how exalted he was that he respected all living entities. He always carried 2 books with him of Narottam Das Thakur. Even though he was illiterate, he had Prema Bhakti Chandrika and Prarthana by Narottam Das Thakur that he always carried with him. And he was always singing the praises of Radha Krishna. Always. He was in such a mood of separation. In fact, people would hear a lady's voice talking to him sometimes in the night. And they became very intrigued. What is this? A Babaji and talking to a woman? And so they spied on him for 2 days and nights. They were watching to see which woman is coming and going. And there was no one. Another time, he was in the hollow of a tree trunk. And again, they could hear a lady's voice. So this time they tried to burst in on the tree trunk and, opened it up. And there was Gaura Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj. He was alone. And then they realized he's talking to Radharani. So he was a very, very exalted personality. In fact, at one point he had become blind. And he arrived at Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj's mutt, I think. And Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj was astonished. How in the midnight, you're blind, how did you come all by yourself? He said, someone held me by the hand and brought me. And there was no one. There was no one. So this is, a very great personality come to teach us pure devotion. That's what we want to aspire for. We want to aspire for pure devotion. So we can't be so renounced. We can't eat mud. Just yesterday, I asked this question to Guru Maharaj. we can't eat mud and survive, you know, like that, like how, because he was so elevated and exalted, he was tasting Chintamani Dham. We were not eating mud. Maharaj said that. So we can only follow. We cannot imitate, but we can feel inspired. And how is it possible to live so renounced? It's possible when you're purely in love with Krishna. So we can renounce all of this material world when we are on the transcendental platform. Those are the lessons we need to understand.
Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you. Thank you for a very nice question. I'm grateful to you for all the wonderful questions you ask because it provokes such a nice discussion.
Sometimes I think I just asking stupid questions because I don't know what I'm talking about.
And never please think like that, because there's no such thing as a stupid question. There's always only good questions, because we learn something. You know, when we ask the question, we learn. When we ask the question, other people benefit from what is spoken. So they say that Srimad Bhagavatam, it is said that the speaker, the hearer, the inquirer, everyone gets purified. So please keep going.
Thank you for your encouragement.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Namta Mataji, you have raised your hand. Please go ahead.
Yes, Babaji. Thank you. Hare Krishna, Mataji. Please accept
Hare
my humble
obeisance. Please accept mine once again. All glories to Prabhupada. All glories to Gurudev.
Yes, all glories to Gurudev, all glories to Prabhupada. Mataji, I wanted to ask the question in context with what you asked yesterday. You asked the question yesterday to Maharaj about Gaur Kishodas Babaji Maharaj. And then there was a statement made by Maharaj. He said that praise and blame are just, you know, the difference of the words. They are both same. I want to understand this. I was just thinking from yesterday itself, and I could not get a clear answer. If you could make it clear, please, it would be helpful.
Of course, when the spiritual master says something, we have to take it very seriously. So this doesn't apply to the words of the spiritual master. Maharaj was talking just about, you know, ordinary dealings. You know, one day people will praise you, they will blame you, criticize you, you know, so praise, honor, dishonor, you know. As we advance in bhakti, at least, we are supposed to become indifferent to heat, cold, pain, distress, happiness, honor, dishonor, because they all pertain to the material world and the material body. So one day we may get praised a lot, and one day we may get criticized heavily. How are we going to take that? How are we going to deal with that? You know, first thing, we have to see the source. First, we have to examine, you know, does this criticism have some nugget of truth? Is there something for me to learn? Or is it just coming out of envy and, you know, desire to disrupt something good or something like that? So we have to examine carefully. And then, you know, we learn something from that. Or we just say, okay, well, I cannot please everyone and go on with our service. The main thing is to be fixed in our service, whether we are getting praised or blamed or criticized, we continue with our service no matter what is happening in the material world. Basically, that's my understanding of what Guru Maharaj was saying. But if the spiritual master criticizes, we have to take it very seriously, because the chastisement, the correction is coming for us to move to a better level in our bhakti by pointing out what we need to work on. And if the spiritual master praises you, hey, that's wonderful. It means Krishna is pleased. Yasya prasadat bhagavat prasado, yasya prasadat nagati kutopi. The only way to please Krishna is by pleasing the spiritual master. Only way. This is the only way we can do it. This is, Srila Prabhupada says, the secret of success is to please the spiritual master. So just clarifying, you know, you know, ordinary people, you know, one day they will blame, one day they will criticize, one day they will praise, and then next day again they'll do the same thing, you know. So we cannot take that too seriously or allow ourselves to be affected by that either. But what the spiritual master says, we take every word coming from the lotus mouth of our spiritual master as very serious for our spiritual life. Make it one with your heart and do not desire anything else. Guru Mukha Padma Vakya Chitete Koriya Aikya Arana Koriho Mani Asha. I hope that clarifies.
Yes, Mataji. Thank you. Thank you very much. It helps.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So we are just 1 minute away from the hour. I don't know, Vrindavannath Prabhu, you're in your office and you're on a tight time schedule, I'm thinking.
Like today I'm working from home, Mataji. And generally, yes, working from office started here in UK also. So, but because Tuesday I have to host, so I try to. Let's, by Krishna mercy, still able to work from home on Tuesday. So. Mataji, can I ask one question?
Of course.
See, this Guru Parampara, I have this from some time. Guru Parampara, earlier I was thinking it's based on Diksha Guru. But it's not based on Diksha Guru because we know it's based on the Shiksha Guru also. But there can be multiple Shiksha Guru in general. So how this actually... like managed, because Gaurakishodas Babaji, Diksha Guru, we don't keep in our parampara, we keep only Shiksha Guru. So yes, we can keep Shiksha Guru, but why we don't keep Diksha Guru also in that parampara? Because they are also in the lineage.
I remember Guru Maharaj was asked this question some time ago, and he answered this question. I wish I could remember the answer, so I must humbly submit that I won't be able to answer you correctly. I cannot recall what Guru Maharaj said, but I can certainly research it and get back to you. Or we can ask Guru Maharaj this question, but I don't know the answer. I am so sorry.
No problem, Mataji.
Okay.
But do you agree, Mataji, with this question in general? Like, or this is a very stupid question in like,
No. It is very, very important to understand it. We must understand what our Guru Parampara is and why it is structured the way it is. We must have a clear understanding. So even I am now, you know, intrigued by your question, and I would also like to research into it more and find out, you know, why we are following the Shiksha Guru system and why the Diksha Guru is not mentioned or worshipped in that, in the disciplic succession line. No, it is not. It's very important. We must be very clear about our Siddhanta. We must be able to defend ourselves. If people ask, what is this? What is that? We must be able to understand. Srila Prabhupada said, anybody should be able to speak on our philosophy if we are asked questions about it. So this is a very fundamental question, actually. I wish I knew the answer, but I don't remember. I remember Guru Maharaj was asked this question, and I remember he answered. In fact,
Mataji, it was me who asked that question that time with Guru Maharaj, and he answered that we follow Shiksha Guru. But what happened after that, in one of the known person, he asked me this question, that why in ISKCON, like you say, Diksha is more important than just Shiksha, because anybody can be Shiksha Guru, but Diksha Guru is the most critical thing. So yes, you can have respect for your Shiksha Guru also. That's not a, like, that's what we mentioned also. But why Diksha Guru are not considered in that lineage? They should be also, ideally. So I was not having answer to that question. And I was thinking, yes, that's a very genuine question. So.
Thank you. Thank you for bringing that out. Certainly, we can ask Guru Maharaj tomorrow and get a very clear understanding. I would also like to hear. Thank you. Thank you for bringing up this important question. It's very important.
Thank you very much.
Fundamental. Thank you. Very nice question.
So Mataji, looks like we don't have any further questions now. Devotee, if you have any questions, we can.
Yeah, you can end the call now. Yeah. And for my humble obeisances to all the devotees for patiently waiting on this call and listening. I thank very much my hosts for doing a wonderful job. I thank you all for overlooking my mistakes and my deficiencies and being patient with me. Thank you very much.
Mataji, you are full of inspiration for all of us. Sorry to disturb
I can't imagine why. You should look at me, really. You come here and see me and then you will say, oh my God, what a mess she is. Ask Soumya Datri what I really am like and then she will tell you. Pray for me, Prabhu. Pray for me.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you very much. Shila Prabhupada ki jai, Guru Maharaj ki jai, Anant Koti Vaishnav Vrind ki jai.
Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Thank you.